I've gotten so many letters from fans inviting me to their schools, so I'd like to invite you to mine. In fact, I'm going to play teacher today. Y'all play the students, okay? Graduating from high school in 1988 was one of the most important things I've done in my life. My favorite subjects were history, English, and math. But today I'm going to teach you something they didn't teach me in school. Something I know really, really well. Mexican-American music. You know, your teacher's only given me about 15 minutes. Don't cry now, okay? So I'll be packing a lot of information in my little class. Ready? Here's my room. Check out my visual aids. Video chalkboard, a great sound system, and a dance floor. Do you ever ride in your car with the windows down and the tape deck or radio up really loud, as if to say to other drivers and people on the street, this music is the best, or this music is me? I think all of us have. Some a little louder than others. I think we all have found musical styles that move us and that we can identify with. American teenagers listen to many kinds of music. I'm Mexican-American, and I grew up in Corpus Christi, Texas, listening to pop, rhythm and blues, rock, country, western, and to music in Spanish. For many Mexican-Americans, music that has Mexican and Mexican-American roots can have a special place in our hearts. When we hear these musical styles, we feel a connection to our culture and to our people. I can't see y'all out there, and even if I could, I wouldn't know your heritage just to look at you. But I wonder if you can think of any music that ties you to your family, to your roots. Today I'm going to share with you some of what I know about music in Spanish that many Mexican-American teenagers all over the United States enjoy today. This music is created in many parts of the United States, including Washington State, New Mexico, Arizona, Illinois, Indiana, Colorado, Texas, and California. Because of our short class, I'm going to concentrate on Texas and California, where most Mexican-American music is created. By the end of my class today, students, you'll be able to name some of these styles and describe them. You're going to explain the roots of the music and historical and cultural influences that have made them what they are. You'll explain that just as all Americans don't favor the same types of music, all Latinos in the U.S. don't listen to the same music either, and neither do all Mexican-Americans. We'll begin in Texas. As I give you a short history of Mexicans in Texas, I want you to think about how the following political and economic events could have had an effect on music. There were Spanish settlements in the area of New Spain that would become Texas beginning in 1690. The region was already populated by a number of American Indian tribes, and Catholic missions were set up to convert the Indians. San Antonio was founded as a town in 1718, and what is now called the Valley of South Texas was first settled by Spain in 1749, a long, long time ago, right? Texas became independent of Mexico in 1836 and was annexed by the United States in 1846. The Mexican population was largely concentrated in South Texas and was isolated from Anglo immigration and culture to a large extent by mistrust and by differing economic interests. Tejano, or Texas Mexican culture, was very much tied to the commercial and cultural center of Monterrey and the Mexican state in Nuevo León. This strong relationship continued even up to the 1920s. Most population interchange was with the Mexican states of Nuevo León, Tamaulipas, and San Luis Potosí. In the 1850s, Germans emigrated to Mexico and to Monterrey, as well as to the United States. Before, after, and during the years of 1910 to 1917, thousands of Mexicans immigrated into Texas, California, and the Southwest. These families were fleeing from the violence of the Mexican Revolution and economic disaster. Many were highly educated professionals. Any ideas about how all this affected music? How about you? Or maybe you? Bueno, first, the isolation of much of the Mexican population from the rest of Texas allowed for continued identification with Mexico and Mexican music. Monterrey supplied many music teachers and musicians to South Texas. The German immigrants to Monterrey brought the accordion, polka, waltz, and other European dance styles, which became popular throughout Mexico and South Texas. The immigration during the Mexican Revolution helped to strengthen and maintain the Spanish language and Mexican culture in Texas. Among these refugees were highly trained musicians and music teachers. The bottom line is that the Tejanos were able to develop a very distinctive musical style because of their isolation. We'll talk about that best known style now. Tejano music is known for its use of el acordeón, the accordion, and for the polka ranchera, waltz, and other rhythms of German origin. Tejano music is performed by conjuntos, orquestas, or grupos. Conjuntos have from 2 to 4 members, with 2 members singing in harmony. The principal instrument is the acordeón, accompanied by a bajo sexto, bass, and drums. The guitar-related instruments trace their heritage to Spain. Orquestas are much larger and include brass instruments such as trumpets, wind instruments such as saxophones and clarinets and violins. The acordeón may be included. Grupos are smaller and often use synthesizers to create a brass, string, and even acordeón sounds. Norteño is very similar to Tejano music. Norteño means northern or of the north, northern Mexico in this case. Norteño groups from Mexico have toured Texas for decades and have been strongly influenced by Tejano music and Tejano fans, especially in their style of acordeón playing. Now, who listens to Tejano music and who listens to Norteño music? It doesn't matter where you're from or what part of the country you live in. You can enjoy both. Tejano music is being more widely marketed now in Mexico, so the public will be growing. The taste of the new audience will have an effect on the Tejano style. Tejano and Norteño are meant to be danced at weddings, birthday parties, festivals, tardeadas, concert dances. People like to dance when they've got the chance. Of course, at school dances and parties, we have top 40, R&B, rap, and Tejano. And now, I will show you how to dance a polka. And in Texas, we always move in a circle around the floor. Why? Perhaps this tradition came from Germany along with the polka and waltz. Country western dance in Texas also moves in a circle. Waltzes are not quite as common, but are danced especially at weddings and quinceañeras, debutante parties. Another rhythm that is very popular is the cumbia. It's a kind of música tropical, or tropical music, because it comes from Colombia and has Afro-Colombian roots. We don't play it in the same way as Colombians do. Cumbia came a long way up through Mexico, and we adapted it in Texas. When we dance cumbia, we can dance side by side, or even together. You know, I always feel super cool and really comfortable when I hear Tejano music. It reminds me of home. I love to dance, and it's a nice and relaxed style. Tejano musicians also sing in English, in country western style, and in pop music styles. We can do anything because we grow up listening to all kinds of music. Speaking of listening to different music, let's move on to California. Just joking. Anyway, the history of Mexican Americans in Southern California is similar, but different enough to have an effect on the music that is popular there. The first Spanish mission in what is now California was founded in San Diego in 1769. The Pueblo of Los Angeles was founded near the Mission of San Gabriel in the year 1781. The Mexicans who moved into the area were often from the state of Sonora. California was taken by the United States after the war with Mexico in 1848 under the Treaty of Guadalupe, 2 years after the annexation of Texas. In spite of the heavy influx of Anglo culture in Southern California, especially after the completion of the railroad lines in the 1880s, the Californianos were able to maintain their customs to some extent. However, the heavy immigration from Mexico from the late 1800s to the 1930s helped to strengthen Mexican culture in Southern California. Much of the immigration to California from Mexico has been from the central and northwestern states of Jalisco, Chihuahua, Zacatecas, Durango, Guanajuato, and Michoacán. For this reason, the ranchera music of Jalisco has always been especially popular in Southern California. Norteño music is also very popular there. Banda, which means band, is also the name of a style of dance music from Zacatecas and Sinaloa, Mexico. It is extremely popular in California right now. In fact, one of the top radio stations, Spanish or English, in the whole city of Los Angeles is a banda station. Banda music comes from brass bands that have performed for many years in many small towns all over Mexico. These bandas were probably influenced by military bands. In recent years, the banda style of Northwest Mexico has been adapted to the taste of a public that also listens to norteño and other popular styles on the radio. Notice the outfits fans wear. I think it's pretty cool to see that apparel in Los Angeles, since LA was a region of Mexican ranches before it was subdivided and settled by Anglos from the Midwest and back east, beginning in the 1880s. And leather boots, belts, and the hats originally came up north from Mexico. Mexican-American music in Los Angeles has been highly influenced by Afro-Cuban and Puerto Rican musical styles, today we call them salsa, by rock and roll, and by African-American styles such as rhythm and blues. Rap and hip-hop are very popular among teenagers, and you might know that already. There are Mexican-American rap groups out of East Los Angeles. Their rap pulls together African-American rap styles, Spanish language, and some Mexican-American topics. You know, music has always reflected the meetings of peoples and cultures. Today, changes in music occur more rapidly than in the past. Why do you think that is? Maybe it's because there is so much media broadcast of music and music videos, and such a wide variety of music is marketed nationally and internationally. You know, the more you know about the incredible variety of music in the United States and the world, the more fun you can have recognizing the new mixes and blends that come out. My gosh, y'all, I ran out of time, and I didn't even get to talk about some of the other kinds of Mexican-American music, our old romantic ballads, rock, songs with the Chicano movement and the United Farm Workers of the 60s and the 70s, the brown sound, wonderful corridos that tell stories of actual events and heroes, mariachi music that makes my heart swell up with Mexican pride when I hear it. You know, all of these styles and more deserve their own program. There are even books that have been and are being written about them. There are probably resources in your area for you to learn more. Mexican-American music has gotten a lot of attention in the last few years. Look at all the Grammys and awards. I even won one in 1993. The appeal of Mexican-American music is growing internationally. Woo! It's about time! So, mis amigos, we've learned a little about the history of Texas and California and how history can affect music. We've heard examples of musical styles in Spanish that are popular with Mexican-American teenagers, like Tejano and Norteña Polka, waltz and cumbia, rap and banda. And you remember that all Mexican-Americans have different tastes, depending on our family, our history, and our environment. Hey, and one more thing I especially want you to know, and the main reason I've come to see you, your high school diploma, is one of the most important things you'll ever achieve in your life. So use your head, my friends. Stay in school. See ya.